Dear students, today we are going to study about the second part of the biomes. Yesterday we have looked after about the terrestrial biomes. Today we are going to study about the types of aquatic biomes. Aquatic biomes can be classified into the two categories. First are marine biomes and second are freshwater biomes. In marine biomes, the biomes are of three types: seashores, open seas, estuaries. And in freshwater biomes, the biomes are streams and rivers, lakes and ponds, and the third category is of marshes. So first of all, we are going to study about the marine biomes. The marine biomes are, as we have studied earlier, that they are seashores, open seas and the estuaries. Before going to study the types of the biomes, we will first discuss about the physical conditions of the biomes. समुद्री वातावरण में जैसा आप लोग जानते हैं कि पानी के अंदर नमक की मात्रा ज़्यादा होती है और यही मात्रा समुद्रों के अंदर वन जीवन या जीवन को प्रभावित करती है. द मैरिन वाटर हैज़ ए हाई कंसनट्रेशन ऑफ साल्ट ऑफ मिनरल्स आयन्स दैट इज अबाउट 3 to 5%. इन मोस्ट अबंडेंट आयन्स आर सोडियम क्लोराइड सल्फर मैग्नीशियम कैल्शियम. द सैलिनिटी ऑफ द वाटर वेरी स्लाइटली एट द सरफेस एंड एट द वेरियस डेप्थ. जैसे हम उसकी गहराई के अंदर या सरफेस के ऊपर आते हैं उसकी सैलिनिटी के ऊपर फर्क पड़ता है. नदियों के मुहाने पर जहाँ वो समुद्र के अंदर मिलती हैं वहाँ पर भी सैलिनिटी कम होने की संभावना होती है. द टेम्परेचर ऑफ द सरफेस वाटर वेरीज एट डिफरेंट लैटिट्यूड्स. इट इज़ अबाउट 28 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड एट द इक्वेटर एंड बिलो जीरो नियर द पोल्स. द मैरिन हैबिटेट्स आर अफेक्टेड बाय द हॉट एंड कोल्ड करंट्स कीप द ओशन वाटर इन द कंटिन्यूस सर्कुलेशन जोन्स दिस कीप द होमोजीनियस कंडीशन ऑफ द सैलिनिटी कंडीशन. सो द हाइड्रोस्टेटिक प्रेशर इज ऑल्सो एनअर फैक्टर विच गोज ऑन इंक्रीजिंग वेन वी मूव डाउनवर्ड इन द ओशन. सो इट इज इट वेरीज फ्रॉम द वन एटमोसफियर ऑन द सर्फेस टू द 1000 एटमोसफियर एट द हाइएस्ट ऑफ द डेप्थ. दीज एनॉर्मस प्रेशर चेंजेस मेक ए प्रोनाउंस इफेक्ट ऑन द डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ द मैरीन हैबिटेट. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट द वर्टिकल जोन ऑफ एन ओशियन. व्हेन वी मूव फ्रॉम द सर्फेस टू द डेप्थ ऑफ द ओशियन वी कैन क्लासीफाई द ओशियन into the three zones. These three vertical zones are on the basis of availability of light. The first zone is the photic zone, or you can say this is the euphotic zone. This zone consists of up to 200 meter and this is the well lighted zone. The second zone is the aphotic zone. It is of the dim light region and it is from 200 to 2000 meters. The third zone is the abyssal zone. It is permanently dark region, no light here, no photosynthesis, and it is below the 2000 meter. Now let us discuss about the aphotic zone. The aphotic zone, which is below the 200 meter depth, can be classified into the three subzones. The first subzone is the mesopelagic zone. It is up to the 200 meter to the 1000 meters, and it is a semi-dark zone. The second subzone is the bathyplagic zone, which extends from the 1000 meters to 2000 meters and it is completely dark for the human beings. The third subzone is the abyssoplagic zone, which is lowermost zone and which is permanently dark and it is of uniform temperature of 3 degrees centigrade and it has very high hydrostatic pressure. Now the classification of ocean, or you can say classification of marine according to habitat condition. पहले आपने उनका light के अनुसार विभाजन किया था कि समुद्र में किस प्रकार से जीवन उसके अंदर होता है. अब जो है हम प्राणियों के रहने के लिए किस प्रकार से habitat को हम divide कर सकते हैं, तो हम marine habitat को दो zones के अंदर divide कर सकते हैं. The first zone is the benthic zone. It forms the floor. जहाँ जहाँ ये समुद्र की सतह है उसको हम इसमें क्लासिफाई करते हैं. द सेकेंड जोन इज द पिलैजिक जोन। इस जोन के अंदर जो वाटर है, क्योंकि समुद्र की सतह हर जगह अवेलेबल नहीं होगी, जैसे हम किनारे से उसकी गहराई तक जाएंगे तो नेचुरली वो जोन होगा, लेकिन साथ साथ जो वाटर है उसकी गहराई भी बढ़ती चली जाएगी। तो इन दोनों का क्लासिफिकेशन हम पढ़ेंगे, बेंथिक जोन इट इज द फ्लोर ऑफ द ओशन एंड द पिलैजिक जोन विच इज द फ्री वाटर जोन। द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड शोज यू अबाउट द बेंथिक जोन। द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ द बेंथिक जोन इज कॉल्ड एज द सुप्रा लिटोरल जोन। समुद्र का किनारा आप इसे कह सकते हैं, समुद्र की बीच इसे आप कह सकते हैं। द सेकेंड पार्ट इज द लिटोरल जोन। द लिटोरल जोन रिप्रेजेंट द एरिया बिटवीन द अपर एंड लोअर टाइड लेवल, यानी समुद्र का वो हिस्सा जहाँ पर ज्वार भाटा लगातार आता है। तो दिस इज ऑल्सो कॉल्ड एज द इंटर टाइडल जोन, इट इज द शोर ऑफ द ओशन। देन द नेक्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ द बेंथिक जोन इज द सब लिटोरल जोन, और यू कैन से द कॉन्टिनेंटल शेल्फ। जैसे ही हम समुद्र के किनारे से उसके अंदर एंटर करते हैं तो उसकी गहराई बढ़ना शुरू हो जाती है। तो इट एक्सटेंड्स फ्रॉम द लिटोरल टू द बिगनिंग ऑफ द कॉन्टिनेंटल स्लोप। तो देर इज रैपिड डिसेंट, गहराई लगातार बढ़ती चली जाती है। आफ्टर द कॉन्टिनेंटल शेल्फ जो गहराई बढ़ेगी इसके अंदर, दैट विल बी कॉल्ड एज द कॉन्टिनेंटल स्लोप। आफ्टर सम डिस्टेंस दिस स्लोप फॉर्म द नेक्स्ट पार्ट कॉल्ड एज द कॉन्टिनेंटल राइज। द कॉन्टिनेंटल स्लोप एंड कॉन्टिनेंटल राइज टुगेदर फॉर्म द बेंथिक जोन। इसके बाद जो समुद्र का जोन होगा, दैट जोन इज कॉल्ड एज द एबाइसल जोन एंड विच इज द फ्लैट ब्रॉड ओशन फ्लोर विद अ टेम्परेचर ऑफ अबाउट 4 degrees centigrade। दिस नेक्स्ट डायग्राम शोज द डिफरेंट पार्ट। यू कैन सी हेयर द बीच रीजन, द लिटोरल जोन, द सब कॉन्टिनेंटल शेल्फ, द सब कॉन्टिनेंटल स्लोप, देन कॉन्टिनेंटल राइज, एंड इन द लोअर मोस्ट रीजन देर इज द एबाइसो पेलेजिक रीजन। सो हेयर द फ्लोर ऑफ द ओशन बिगन्स। द नेक्स्ट स्लाइड शोज यू द पेलेजिक जोन। इसके अंदर हम समुद्र के फर्श के साथ साथ उसके अगर हम आगे चले जाएं तो समुद्र में जो पानी मिलता है उसको गहराई के अनुसार उसको हमने बांटा हुआ है। तो इस पेलेजिक जोन को हम दो हिस्सों में बांट सकते हैं। द फर्स्ट जोन इज कॉल्ड एज द नेरिटिक जोन। नेरिटिक जोन जो है दैट इज प्रेजेंट अबव द सब लिटोरल जोन और कॉन्टिनेंटल शेल्फ। और ये लगभग किनारे से लेकर अगर हम समुद्र के बीच में चलें तो 200 मीटर की गहराई तक ये जोन हमें मिलता है। द सेकेंड पार्ट इज द ओपन सी जोन। ओपन सी जोन इज बियॉन्ड द नेरिटिक जोन एंड इट इज डिवाइडेड अकॉर्डिंग टू डेप्थ ऑन द फॉलोइंग टाइप। जैसा कि स्लाइड में आप देख रहे हैं, इसमें दर्शाया गया है कि अपर रीजन साइड वाइज ऑफ द नेरिटिक जोन विच इज वेल इल्यूमिनेटेड एंड दिस जोन इज कॉल्ड एज द एपिपेलेजिक जोन। द नेक्स्ट जोन इज द एफोटिक पेलेजिक जोन विच कैन बी डिवाइडेड इंटू द 3 पार्ट, मीजोपेलेजिक, बैथिपेलेजिक एंड द एबाइसोपेलेजिक। द फर्स्ट जोन ऑफ द एफोटिक पोर्शन दैट इज इट हैज सम लाइट बट इट इज नॉट सफिशियंट टू कैरी आउट द फोटोसिंथेसिस। सो यू कैन सी इन दिस डायग्राम, सो अदर टू जोन्स दैट इज बैथिपेलेजिक जोन एंड द एबाइसोपेलेजिक जोन, दीज आर डार्क एंड विदाउट एनी लाइट, सो नो फोटोसिंथेसिस अकर्स इन दोज एरियाज। देन वी कम टू आर द ओपन सीज। ओपन सीज वाटर इंक्लूड्स बियॉन्ड द कॉन्टिनेंटल शेल्फ, या यू कैन से दैट द बियॉन्ड द डेप्थ ऑफ 200 meters फ्रॉम द शोर। द फिजिकल फैक्टर्स दे आर ओपन सी आर सो वास्ट दैट देयर फिजिकल कंडीशंस वेरी ग्रेटली इन द डिफरेंट रीजन्स। द फैक्टर्स दैट शो वेरिएशन इंक्लूड्स आर डेप्थ, प्रेशर, टेम्परेचर, ऑक्सीजन कॉन्टेंट्स ऑफ द वाटर। द ओपन सी हैज ऑल द 3 light zones, फोटिक जोन, एफोटिक जोन एंड द एबाइसल जोन। सी वाटर इज ऑफ कंटिन्यूस सर्कुलेशन ड्यू टू द सर्कुलेशन ऑफ वाटर, ड्यू टू द वाटर करंट। सो द नाउ वी कैन डिस्कस अबाउट द ऑर्गेनिज्म, अबाउट द एनिमल कम्युनिटी ऑफ द ओपन सीज। द ऑर्गेनिजम्स ऑफ ओपन सीज आर क्लासिफाइड इकोलॉजिकली इन टू द 3 categories, The first are planktons, the second category is the nectons, and the third category of the benthos. The planktons are the small organisms which are drifted passively in the surface of water. So they are helpless and they move according to the current of the water and current of the wind. So they have very weak or no locomotory organs at all. So these includes phytoplanktons, diatoms, zooplanktons like protozoans, tiny crustaceans, larvae and the eggs. The planktons are confined to the photic region only. Now we will discuss about the nectons. These are actively swimming animals. They have well developed locomotory organs. They occur in surface as well as deep water. They occur in the surface as well as deep waters. They include jellyfishes, cuttlefishes, sharks, bonefishes, turtles, snakes, seals, whales, etc. The nectons occur in both photic and aphotic zones. They feed mainly on the planktons, or you can say smaller nectons. Now we will discuss about the benthos. These are the bottom dwelling animals that crawl over, burrow into or attach to the bottom. Crabs, starfishes, brittle stars and sea urchins you can commonly found there. You can also found clams, worms, sand sea cucumbers, sponges, corals, sea pens and the tunicates are also present there. Now we will move to the next slide. The benthonic organisms include sugar producers and more consumers. They are sponges also. They are decomposing bacteria also. Animals feed on the falling carcasses or on each other. So a fierce competition goes on in the seawater. So filter feeder stain food out of the water. The visceral zone, lakes producer, because there is no light. Only predators occur here. Some of these have very large jaws armed with sharp teeth. Certain fishes like devilfish, hatchetfish, etc. They have some luminescent organs which emit light continuously to attract the prey. Now we will discuss about the seashore. The seashores include shallow waters over the gently sloping continental shelves. They extend from the coastline to the depth of 200 meters. So they are subdivided into the two zones, intertidal or subtidal zone. Now we will discuss the first type of zone that is called as intertidal region. So hum samundar ke kinare ke upar jo ecosystem hai, jo sorry biomes hai, unke bare mein baat karne ja rahe hain. The intertidal region, it lies between the low and high tide and include waters up to 50 meters deep. The intertidal region is alternatively exposed and covered by the water due to the tidal effect in every day and night period. The tidal action changes of temperature, light, moisture and salinity. There is abundance of light, oxygen, carbon dioxide and minerals, and this makes the intertidal region one of the most favorable habitats of the world. The intertidal region flourishes with life. There are three types of intertidal zone: muddy, sandy and the rocky shores, and they support the different type of the communities. The mud is flat, so mud forms a flat surface which occurs where water moves slowly enough to deposit a sediment or small particles. Algae cover the particles and provide food for a variety of burrowing worms, crustaceans and corals. Sandy beaches are less stable than the mud flats because sand shifts constantly and dries out faster. So minute protists, worms and crustaceans living between the sand grains feed on planktons which are stranded when tide is out. So many kinds of shore birds feed on these invertebrates. Now we move to the next slide. Muddy and sandy shores do not provide desired anchorage to the sessile animals or seaweeds. These organisms abound on the rocky shores. Here occur algae of many types, sponges, barnacles, mollusks, tunicates, etc. Among the loose stones near the high tide mark area, great variety of crustaceans are there. A number of birds visit at low tide to scavenge or prey on the invertebrates. Now we will discuss about the coral reefs or intertidal region. Coral reefs occur in the clear, shallow, warm water where temperature rarely falls below 20 degrees centigrade and there is enough light for the photosynthesis. Reefs are made up of calcareous material secreted by the coral polyps, tube worms and the foraminiferals. Maximum diversity of biota is seen in the coral reefs. A reef being rocky provides anchorage for algae and sessile animals. A variety of swimming invertebrates are there. Coral reefs is the highly productive part of the coastal region. Now we will discuss about the subtidal zone. It is seaward to the intertidal zone and varies in depth from about 50 to some 200 meters. No, it is no exposure for the air. Wave action and temperature fluctuations are less. Light is abundant. Water is well oxygenated. Mineral nutrients are readily available. And bottom is more uniform and is formed of sand and mud mixed with shells and stones. Subtidal zone is also thickly populated. Planktons include minute algae and the protozoans. Nekton comprise variety of fishes. Benthos have large seaweeds, sponges, crustaceans, sea urchins, sea cucumbers, brittle stars, worms and the mollusks. Fishing area is the most important part. It is the subtidal zone that most of the world's important fishing areas are present. Beyond the continental shelf, the slope abruptly steepens and is referred to as the continental slope. The latter usually has ridges. Continental slope levels off into a more or less horizontal ocean floor. Now we will discuss about the estuaries. Estuaries are the region where rivers enter the oceans are known as the estuaries. Estuary waters are very fertile. Minerals, oxygen, carbon dioxide and light are available in plenty. Water is less saline than in the sea and as it mixes with the fresh water from the rivers. Tidal action brings about rapid circulation of the nutrients. Estuary water often have more life than the adjacent sea or fresh water up to the river. Planktons include microscopic organisms like diatoms, algae, protozoans and the small crustaceans. Benthic life comprises of algae, fixed plants, snails, prawns, crabs, oysters, skates, etc. Now we move towards the freshwater biomes. We can classify freshwater biomes as the streams and rivers, lakes and ponds and the marshes. Ponds. The ponds are the small but they are very common. Every village has a pond. It may be natural or it may be man-made. The ponds receive water from the rain and surface runoff. Ponds vary greatly in size, often seasonal. Large ones are perennial ponds. Pond water is not entirely still, it is circulated by the wind. Temperature is more or less uniform. Oxygen, carbon dioxide, minerals are uniformly distributed. Now we will discuss about the vegetation in the ponds. The vegetation include planktons. The phytoplanktons, composed chiefly of algae, may cover the entire surface as scum. Zooplanktons include protozoans, rotifers, minute crustaceans, eggs, larvae, etc. There may be some water insects like mayflies, dragonflies or damselflies. The large surface floating plants like Wolfia, Salvinia, Pistia, Azolla are drifted around by the wind. There are certain macrophytes like Ceratophyllum, Utricularia. They float just below the water surface. The next slide discuss about the benthos. The large rooted plants like Hydrilla, Vallisneria, Lotus, Water Lily, Trapa grow at the bottom. The bottom dwelling animals include Hydra, worms, prawns, crabs, mussels, snails. There are some birds like herons, waterfowls, ducks occurs in and around the ponds. Now we will discuss about the lakes. First of all, we will classify the lakes according to the how much plant life they can support. They are of three types: eutrophic lake, oligotrophic lake and the mesotrophic lake. We will discuss about eutrophic lake now. These are shallow lakes and they are rich in nutrients, so they are rich in life also. They have little oxygen because decomposer organisms rapidly use it up, metabolizing the organic matter. Dull lake is the classic example of eutrophic lake. Normally a lake ages as it is steadily filled in with minerals and organic matter and become more eutrophic at its ages. So the natural eutrophication takes thousands of years, but the process may speed it up if the water is polluted by the sewage water or by the agricultural water. Then we will discuss about the mesotrophic lake. These have moderate nutrients as well as the moderate primary productivity. They show intermediate depths in proportion to the surface area. Oxygen contents is medium. Water of such lake also show the medium turbidity. Now we will discuss about the oligotrophic lakes. These lakes are deep lakes with steepy rocky sides and narrow littoral zones. They are low in nutrients such as phosphorus, calcium, nitrogen. Therefore, they support few organisms. The water is dark, but it is very clear. Deep water also contains oxygen. Some lakes have saline or brackish water, like Sambar Lake of Rajasthan. Now we will discuss about the thermal stratification of the lake. Three different layers are formed due to the difference in temperature in the lake. The first layer is called as the epilimnium. It is the upper layer of lake and contains warm water that circulates freely although poor in nutrients. It receives proper sunlight and it is reflected through well aerated and they contains a lot of phytoplanktons. Oxygen is produced due to photosynthesis and wind mixes up with the water. This slide shows and gives you idea about the different area of the thermal stratification. The upper surface is the epilimnium zone, the middle surface is metalimnium zone, and the lower surface is the hypolimnium zone. The metalimnium zone is the middle zone, as we have shown you, and it is characteristic feature is the rapid fall in water temperature with increasing depth. The hypolimnium is the deep non-circulating and cold zone which forms the bottom layers. This zone is quite rich in nutrients, although the amount of oxygen is low. Now we will discuss about the lakes, the physical factors of the lake. They depend upon the source of water, location, altitude, latitude and the surrounding biomes. Small lake and the peripheral shallow parts of the large lakes have physical factors and forms of life almost similar that found in the ponds. In the lake's open surface water occur floating plants. They need light. Animal depends upon them, like fishes and the small arthropods. Deep waters of the large lakes are still and have less oxygen, poor light and low temperature, So the vegetation is comparatively very low and animal life is represented by the few annelid worms, clams and the midget larvae. Now I'll discuss about the marshes. The marshes are temporarily flooded and low-lying areas adjoining the roads, rail tracks, rivers, lakes and in forest. Light, oxygen and minerals are plenty. Planktons are scanty due to the turbid water. Water-loving plants such as reeds, cattails, water, hyacinths and animals such as aquatic insects, insect larvae, snails, small fishes, frogs and water birds are common. Now we will discuss about the artificial ecosystem. The natural systems are mostly free from the human activities and disturbances. That is why they are surviving up till now. Such systems are tropical forests, grasslands, deserts, lakes, oceans, etc. Artificial ecosystems are man-made ecosystems and they are formed by modification of natural ecosystems. The conversion of natural forests and grasslands into crop fields is the best example of artificial ecosystem. The agrosystem is the most common example. They are the modification of the natural ecosystem that took place due to the human activity which arise due to their needs for food, etc. Domestication of the animals and the origin of agriculture created the artificial ecosystem in the past. The features of artificial ecosystem we will discuss now. There is absence of self-regulatory mechanism. As natural ecosystem has a natural balance, they have natural equilibrium. But in artificial ecosystem, that balance has to be maintained by the humans itself. Then there are lack of circulation of nutrients. Like in your agricultural fields, you have to provide continuous supply of the fertilizers to maintain the nutrients. Lack of biodiversity. The lack of biodiversity is another disadvantage of artificial ecosystem. So they are more susceptible to the diseases. So the natural ecosystem which have more diversity, which have more species of plants and animals, have better capability to fight with the natural calamities. As I have discussed earlier, the artificial ecosystems are more susceptible to natural calamities like droughts, floods and the diseases, etc. The artificial ecosystem requires the irrigation as well as the fertilizers. So students, we have discussed about the aquatic biomes of the world and you see that there is large amount of diversity which is present in the aquatic system as well as the terrestrial system. Thank you.